deep in star-forming regions such as this, in the disks around young stars, the delicate interplay between gas and dust is creating planets. Professor Sasha Hinkley and his team in the Astrophysics Group at the University of Exeter are world experts at directly imaging the faint planets that orbit young stars. He also leads an international collaboration pushing the frontiers of direct imaging using one of the most ambitious observatories ever built, the James Webb Space Telescope.
So I'm Sasha Hinkley. I'm an associate professor here at the University of Exeter in the physics department. So I've been leading a big team of international astronomers for about the past 6 years to be some of the first users of the James Webb Space Telescope. One of the advantages that JWST has over its precursor, the Hubble Space Telescope, is its just raw sensitivity in the infrared especially. And this allows it to do a couple of things. It allows JWST to see some of the most distant and faintest objects in the entire universe. The other thing that the James Webb Space Telescope is able to do is to really observe the faint glow from extrasolar planets. And this is basically the faint glow that they retain from their formation process. We've developed a broad international consortium of hundreds of people at all kinds of career stages, men, women, PhD students, professors, and we've really brought the community together to try to understand how we can best use this observatory to answer these questions. It has a huge price tag, so we really need to make sure that all the observations we're doing are done in the most efficient way and the most impactful way. And that's really what our mission was. So the concept for the James Webb Space Telescope was conceived probably more than 20 years ago. It was a huge technological challenge that would require dozens of countries and literally thousands of scientists and engineers and technicians to build this precision observatory to really address some of the most fundamental questions in cosmology, extragalactic astronomy, but also more small scale, like with extrasolar planets. The environment that JWST has to exist in space is an incredibly harsh one. It's incredibly cold. There are harsh energetic particles coming from the sun. There's even little micrometeoroids, little pebbles in space that are bombarding the mirror of James Webb. And so a tremendous amount of testing needed to go into making sure that it would be able to withstand these incredibly harsh conditions. And this testing had to take place all over the country, all over the United States. And James Webb had to be moved from place to place over the course of many, many years. All of this had a tremendous cost. It took a huge amount of time and required just armies of people making sure that it would go right. It involved putting it in a giant refrigerator to cool it down, to make sure that it would be able to pass that test. It involved putting it in a giant chamber to shake it, to make sure that it would be able to withstand the incredible energy of launch, to make sure nothing came loose. So it had to pass all of these tests over the course of many, many years. And then finally, it was all assembled in Los Angeles in the United States, put on a boat, taken through the Panama Canal, all the way down to French Guiana, where it was installed in the largest rocket that is available to mankind, called the Ariane 5. So it was decided that the launch of JWST should happen on Christmas morning, 2021. I think we can all agree that Christmas morning is already kind of a busy and stressful time. And when you throw in the launch of mankind's most incredible observatory, it can really make for an interesting Christmas morning. My family and I were all waiting for it. My three little girls couldn't wait to see it. We didn't really get the live feed up until there was about maybe a minute left to go or maybe 2 minutes left to go. And all of a sudden, I just had this incredible feeling of, oh my goodness, this is it. What if we're not ready? What if something wasn't checked? The pull of the launch kind of sucked everything with it and sucked us in. The launch engineer was counting down in French, because it's a French rocket company, counting down 10, 9, 8. And before I knew it, there was the fire of the launch, and all of a sudden it was off. There was only a few seconds before it broke through the clouds, and I couldn't believe that it was actually off and on its own, because there had been so many years of seeing pictures of it in the laboratory and pictures of it in the assembly facility, and finally, it was off. There was a moment after launch where the live feed switched to the onboard camera inside the rocket. And then there was a moment when they just released it from the rocket. And the live feed was not very good. It was broken and choppy. And so it was a little bit hard to make it out, but I could clearly make out the edge of the Earth and the ocean very clearly. And you could see just the edge of JWST. That was our last ever view of JWST directly. And watching it go off from the rocket was this incredibly exciting but also terrifying moment where there were no more cables attached to it. It was completely detached from the rocket, and it was completely on its own. It was almost like, you know, sending a child off into the world or something without anybody to look after it. And I was still sitting there with my family, and there was still a feeling of something could still go wrong. Something could still happen, and this $10 billion flagship mission could be lost. And then there was a moment, you could just barely make it out through the live feed, but the solar panel started to deploy on Webb, and I knew, okay, thank goodness. At least it's got the solar panel, at least it can power itself. And I knew then that things were hopefully gonna be okay. So after the launch on Christmas Day and into the days in early 2022, the deployment gradually unfolded, no pun intended, and each day a new milestone was crossed, whether that was the deployment of the primary mirror, of the optics, of the secondary mirror, but every time a new milestone was passed, that meant that all of those potential problems that could have arisen didn't. And so with every day, it became increasingly clear that this is probably gonna work. And even if it doesn't work perfectly, it's still gonna be amazing. And I'm really happy to say that by the time that it got to the end of its deployment after a couple of weeks, everything that had to go off without a hitch and work perfectly did. The launch was highly successful. The timing of the launch was really effective. The efficiency of the launch was really effective. And this means that JWST is going to have a lot more petrol in the tank, if you will, to have an extremely long lifetime. When it was built, it was thought that this might only last 5 to 10 years. But now people are regularly saying that this is going to last maybe 20 years. And I heard the other day, maybe even 25 years. So this is really good news for a young person that's thinking about a career in astronomy, that this incredible observatory is going to be around for at least another 20 years and allowing them just year after year of breakthrough science to carry on. There was a moment in August of 2022 where I was able to look at the first data that was processed by one of my former PhD students. And it was the first direct image of an extrasolar planet that had been obtained by JWST. And there was a moment I remember looking at the image and I remember thinking, nobody has ever seen an extrasolar planet at these wavelengths of light. I mean, I'm looking at something that humanity has never really looked at before. And that was an amazing feeling, and I can still feel it as I talk about it. And I knew that we were going to find out a tremendous amount of information about the atmospheres, the compositions of these exoplanets, and that was going to allow us to do really breakthrough science with this observatory. So I've been lucky enough to have about 100 hours of time on the James Webb Space Telescope. And these data that are coming down are regularly used by not just my PhD students that are working with me or my postdoctoral scholars, but actually the fourth year physics students that are on the MPhys program are actually working with these data, processing these data for their master's level projects. So I think that this is really something that Exeter offers, is this ability to work with the world's greatest data for university students here.